We are in the house of the Lord one more time. Thank God for his grace and his mercy. We thank God for bringing us here today, because we know without a shadow of a doubt that if it had not been for the Lord on our side, we would not have died. Good morning, my sister. How you doing? Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. We just thank God for another day. And we're here to worship with his spirit and in truth. Amen. You know that God is able to do all things exceedingly and abundantly more than we could ever ask or think. So as we get ready to go into our worship service, we want to thank God and welcome each and every one of you who are on the conference call line this morning and on our Facebook Live line this morning. We want to thank you and welcome you to Morningstar Baptist Church here in the great city of Aurora, Virginia, sitting at the base of the mountain out in the sweet, beautiful countryside. Everything is lovely out here this morning. The sun is shining. The birds are chirping. It's a nice, crisp morning out here, and we just thank God that we're in the house of prayer on this day. Amen. Wherever you are, wherever you're comfortable at right now, I pray that the Lord will continue to bless you right where you are. Because you know when the blessings go up, when the praises go up, the blessings truly go down. So we're going to go ahead and get started with our service today. This is our pink Sunday service. We're wearing pink today. If you can look out at the congregation, you can see a whole bunch of beautiful pink people. So we just thank God for that on this day. Amen. Amen. But we're going to go ahead and get into the worship service. And remember, when the praises do go up, the blessings what? Come down. So you guys get ready to bless the Lord at this time. Just stand on your feet. We're going to go into the worship service, our worship song that we're getting ready to play. And just remember that every praise, amen, every praise belongs to God. Amen. Raise the praise up in here. Amen. Let's go, let's go, let's go.
Every word of worship for one accord. Every prayer, every the atmosphere.
Yeah.
And it just rolls from each and every one of us from breast to breast and heart to heart. Amen.
Amen.
Oh my God, let's just continue to praise Him all through this service. Amen. It's a wonderful day to be in the house of the Lord.
Amen.
On today. We just thank God for another day's journey. I'm going to allow our associate minister right now, Reverend Johanna, to come over. And she's going to give us the scripture reading. And she's going to take over the prayer and the scripture reading for the rest of the service. And the Lord says, so I'll be back later.
Mm-hmm.
Bring it.
Amen.
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 Yeah.
Hallelujah. First Lady of Voice of Baptist Church. The dynamic and beautiful and capable and educated Miss Charmin Brooks. Domestic violence, and but today I'm going to just, there are several here in the congregation that have been touched by breast cancer. They're either survivors, they either are related to survivors that have now gone on, their primary diagnosis was breast cancer. And so so we're all aware of this. You know what it is. You also know that men are susceptible, if you didn't, men are also susceptible to breast cancer as well. And it doesn't necessarily mean that because someone in your family has had breast cancer, that you're going to have breast cancer. I know several women that have been diagnosed, survived, breast cancer, and they have no history of it in their family. You know, they're the first one, the only one. Okay, so don't think that just because, oh, well, it's not in my family, it's not going to happen because it can. Okay? There's a scripture I came up, because y'all know I'm kind of the activist person, too. I don't have my Black Lives Matter mask on because it didn't match my pink. And when I say activism, it's important for me to educate and for others, all of my people, to know what you're up against.
Amen.
And to be aware and to be ready to fight, defend for everyone and for ourselves and for everyone. And so one of the scriptures that I came across, speak up for those who cannot speak for themselves, for the rights of all who are destitute. Speak up and judge fairly. Defend the rights of the poor and the needy. And that's Proverbs 31, 8 through 9, NIV version. And so don't take poor as without money. Poor in spirit, poor in health, needy in, needy in support, compassion, knowledge, etc. The poor and the needy. That's all of us. So, breast cancer is the most imperative health issue facing African American women. Though Black women get breast cancer at a slightly lower incidence, so occurrence rate, so 3%, than white women, Black women are 42% more likely to die of breast cancer than white women. That is an astounding number and indicative of a variety of factors, many reflecting racial disparities. And so, what I want to bring forth is the fact that, yes, breast cancer affects us all, but it affects us Black women at a higher rate than, not at a higher rate, it causes death at a higher rate than other races, okay? And so why is that, okay? You know that, if you don't know, you should be examining your breasts every month, okay? You know that you should be going to your mammogram, yearly mammograms. And what's interesting, if you don't have insurance, that can be a challenge. Because who's going to pay for this? Companies, the politicians, I don't know what you want to call at this point, I lost my words, but they don't want to pay for preventative health. They kick us to the curb, it's like, no, we're not going to pay for that. is this such a problem? Why are we dying so unnecessarily? Well, one, and this is coming from sisters, I forgot the name of the website, I'll come back to you, but we are not taking action. While 92% of black women agree breast health is important, only 25% have recently discussed breast health with their family, their friends, or their colleagues. And only 17% have taken steps to understand their personal risk for breast cancer. We are usually at a more advanced stage of breast cancer once it's detected, okay? We usually don't have access to health care or health insurance, so we may be at a lower frequency or longer intervals between mammograms. So because we don't have access, we don't have money, we don't have the funds, we don't know where we can go. You know, there's a lot of free services offered, but we need to be aware of them. We need to make our families, our people aware of them, that they need to go and have this done. And, you know, even myself, don't put off 3 years of getting a mammogram because you say you're too busy. That was me. I'm being honest. You know, black women, we have a tendency not to follow up on abnormal mammogram results because either we can't afford the diagnostic testing or we're in denial. Simple as that. We're in denial. This is going to go away. I'm not going to go anywhere. I'm not going to go follow up. It's going to go away. And so we need to get treatment. We don't have the same high quality access to treatment compared to white women. And I'm not trying to necessarily make this a racial issue, but it is a racial disparity. And so when I think about testing, when I think about, you know, when we're doing testing, for example, research. Do you know what the research, who's having the research, what our primary, how do I say it? The research is being done on not us, not women, it's done on white men. That's what most of the breast cancer research has been done on over the years. And so it's important that we start, you know, having things done for us, on us, etc. I don't want to stay up here long because I could go on and on. How do we prevent it? What can we do? What can we do to address this? One, breast self-exams, monthly exams. So if you're still menstruating after your period, okay, after, not before, because you have still have lumps, you know, changes, etc. Diet, have it, improve your diet, healthy vegetables, low carbs, like low fatty, bad, I'm sorry, I'm having a, you know, low starches, exercise, so inactivity, and, you know, those of us, all of us, we've been suffering from, you know, being in this COVID pandemic. We've been in the house since March, per se. We've got to figure out something that we can do. We got to exercise. How many of y'all put on the extra 20 pounds? Go ahead, admit it. 15 COVID pounds. We got to figure out what are we going to do to get rid of that. So increase our exercise somehow. Walk around your neighborhood. Improve your diet. Get rid of the, you know, the fast foods, the high fat, you know, try low fat, lean proteins, vegetables, fruits. Increase our fluids, decrease the alcohol. So when I say increase the fluids, I say clear fluid. I'm not talking about vodka. I get it. It's clear. It's a fluid. But decrease your, because, you know, alcohol intake puts us at higher risk for cancer. Y'all like that, didn't you? Also, for those of us that are either menopausal, postmenopausal, estrogen replacement also puts us at risk for breast cancer, okay? So, you know, think about the choices. And I know we have a survivor or two in the audience, and, you know, I thank God for y'all. I thank God for you all. You know, I know several survivors. But then I also thank God for my sister Bernie. I see her over there laughing at me. You know, I say, I mean, and I thank God for her fight.
Yes.
You know,
yes.
Her when we first came to this church, you know, she was going through, I don't know, was it her second bout? And she always was so happy. She was always smiling. And then, you know, I saw the hair come back. And, you know, the Bernie that y'all knew before I came here, you know, before we came here. But then, you know, we progressed on. But she was still always happy, positive, supportive. And, you know, now I miss my cut-up buddy. You know, we used to sit over there and cut up. And I was like, oh, I'm supposed to be the first lady, but that's all right. I'm having a good time over here. So now I have Mama cut up. But, you know, she's over there and I'm over here. But, you know, survivors, okay? She's not here, but I still consider her a survivor.
Yeah.
Because you all remember, you know, her surviving spirit.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That's great. And so, survivor. And so those of us that are here now, we need to make sure that, you know, we look out for ourselves and one another. We have to be activists. You know, we're at a disadvantage. We've been at a disadvantage since we've been put on this earth. And we've got to make a change. We've got to figure out how to change. And we can do that. We can do that. I mean, it's more than just words. We can do that. I'm not going to talk about politics. All I'm going to say is that we can do that. We have to get access to stuff and use it. Okay?
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. You speak of women, the breast cancer, men also get it, so they need to be diligent as well to check themselves.
Yes, men do have breast cancer.
Yeah.
What's interesting, and it's not funny you mentioned this, I'm doing, you know, I teach, and we just finished assessment. And initially, I did mention that men are at risk for breast cancer.
Mm-hmm.
And it's interesting how many healthcare providers don't recognize that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? It's interesting. So, just because you're a nurse, I'm a nurse, Dr. Mayfield's a physician, it's interesting how there was a situation where a man was ordered a mammogram. And the provider, not the one that ordered it, but when they went to have the mammogram, the provider was like, oh, this is out of me. Mistake your name. Why are you getting a mammogram? And I'm like, are you sure that was a physician that said that? And it was. And so, yes, men. And so if, you know, and I go back to heredity. A lot of people are diagnosed and don't have it in their history, right? But then those that do have it in their history, so little baby, your family. So you should have a mammogram or just be, you know, if you know that in your family line someone has had some type of cancer, then it's important for you to be assessed. And I know this isn't colon cancer or rectal cancer or prostate cancer month either, but it's cancer. Men, y'all need to get your all of us need to get our colonoscopies.
Mm-hmm.
Even if they charge you an extra $1,000, we got to figure out a way to get these tests done. Because it's imperative. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Again.
Oh, he was blessed, right?
Amen.
Yes, yes. He was blessed, yes. He was blessed. diligent.
You gotta be aware of what's going on with our bodies as we get older. We all get older.
Talk for yourself.
Oh, yeah. I hear you. Well, everybody's in pink today.
Woo!
Woo-hoo! Pink day. And you're right, Mr. Burgess sit right over there.
Uh-huh.
Looking at him. Amen.
Amen.
Y'all remember Miss Burton? That smile on her face.
Yeah.
She used to crack me up. I mean, but she was so real. Mm-hmm. It was just unbelievable. And I'm so glad that he grew up here.
This is where you can come and just let loose. Let God have his way, amen.
Amen.
And he will have a blessing for you on the other side. He'll have a blessing for you even right here while we're sitting here. I believe we've all just been blessed.
Yes, sir.
Beyond measure on today. And we still have a word from the Lord, amen.
Amen.
We still have a word from the Lord. And it's going to be coming out of the book of 2 Corinthians. The book of 2 Corinthians on today. And I'm just gonna get to this scripture. We're coming out of 2 Corinthians chapter 4. And we're going to be starting off with verse number 7. And if you can just meditate with me for a minute, if you feel like you don't need to rest on your feet, just chill. Just relax and let the word reach out to you. The Bible says in verse 7, but we have this treasure in jars of clay, to show that the surpassing power belongs to God and not us. We are afflicted in every way, but not crushed. We are perplexed, but not driven to despair. We are persecuted, but not forsaken. We are struck down, but not destroyed. Always carrying in the body the death of Jesus, that's the Spirit of the Lord, so that the life of Jesus may also be manifested in our bodies. For he who live are always being given over to death for Jesus' sake, so that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our mortal bodies. So death is at work in each and every one of us. And it is also life that is at work in each and every one of us as well. And his word is blessed. The title of the message is simply, the power belongs to God. When we get it in our minds and understand that the power that we think we have is not our power. It is the power of God that is in us. How many of you all know that being a steward is somebody who can be entrusted with the careful responsibility of managing something that somebody may give you to hold on to? One of the things that we as believers, we have to understand that the knowledge and the good news that we have about Jesus Christ that is inside of us lets us know that we are in a position to reach out to those who do not know who he is. But it also lets us know that we, these lives that we live in, these lives that we have right now, our bodies are vessels or containers or jars of clay where God lives and works through us to reach other folks. How many of you all can think back to the day where when you were a kid, if your mom and dad had a china cabinet, and you knew that you better not touch that china cabinet, because we didn't eat off of this every day. I took it out of the china cabinet, babe. I got it. I got Fort Knox wrapped. Because it was, you know, China goes way back in people's lives. Some folks have China from 50 years ago. You know, great grandparents had it or whatever, and it's been passed down, so it's very valuable. It's a very valuable piece of pottery. Amen. But don't you know, and most of us, we live day to day with everyday stuff. Stuff that we use. Now, this is my coffee cup. I use this one all the time. You know, those of us who are in the military know we don't wash our cups out.
decision. I keep drinking coffee out of it. So it's something that we use at all times. But we will keep that good china, the same type of material that we're eating and drinking out of. We'll put this in a glass case china cabinet and not use it until special occasion comes. Thinking that because it's rare and it's gold rimmed or whatever it is, that it's irreplaceable. But I'm here to tell you that everything on this earth is replaceable. Nothing is permanent. And we have assigned a label on stuff that we want to hold on to. So the actual worth of the china that we're looking at is only because it has a sentimental value to it. The good china is mostly for looking and is only used when we really need to use it. Hallelujah. Our everyday dishes, though, are considerably of less value and are replaceable. Amen?
Amen.
You go to Walmart and replace this cup. Shoot, right now, I'm going to Dollar General and get a cup. But we have to understand that we can either replace the piece of the whole set or replace just one because of how this china is set up. You got to buy the whole set of it. You can't just replace one piece. And I know that I've seen, we actually broke a little piece of ours off, so we trying to glue that thing back so that we wouldn't have to go out and spend a whole lot of money to replace it. So we have to understand, too, that, you know, this type of pottery that we use each and every day, we don't use it and take it and start throwing it at people across the room. We don't try to knock somebody out with it. We handle it carefully, but because we can throw it in the dishwasher, we can do whatever we want to do with it. Even when it's chipped and discolored, we still will use this thing. Constant cycle of being dirty and washed and restacked in the cupboard, whatever it, we're constantly using this stuff, but this vessel is not being used. And some of us may be living under the illusion that we are like fine china. I'm going somewhere. Some of us think that we don't have a bag of chips. We too cool to be careful. We don't have to worry about nothing. We got it, we think we got it all under control. We think we have all the power that we need to get the job done. But just like this piece of fine china, you will find yourself sitting on a shelf, powerless, with no means of taking care of business unless you allow the Lord to come in and do the work. I got 3 points and I'm out of here. The first one is that God lives in and through ordinary people. We're all just ordinary people out here. None of us are special in the sense of we're doing great things that we can pat ourselves on the back and say it was all about us. We're smart enough to realize that when we do great things that are affecting our lives and people outside, when it's affecting the things that's going on in this world, we can give God the glory because of it. This precious treasure. In verse 7, it's saying that the light and the power that shines within each and every one of us in our earthly vessels is not the power being of us, it is the power of God. So everyone can see that our glorious power is coming from the Lord and is not of our own. The text begins by having a contrast of two different things, right? It says what? It says the image of the precious treasure, and the precious treasure is Jesus Christ, and the other is the earthen vessel or clay jar. That means that we are the pot. We are the clay, and he is the potter. The precious treasure is a great substance because it lets us know that the jar is not as valuable as we think it is. The precious treasure that we have in the jar that we are carrying in our hearts is the glory of God that has been revealed through Jesus Christ. And when we are told that we are jars of clay, when we are told that God has placed himself in the very sitting here, it's just a reminder of how fragile we truly are. All of us are getting old. We are. Some of us are a little older than others. We all have ailments in our bodies. Things start breaking down and situations start making it hard to get up in the morning. Your knees start aching. Your back is hurting. Or whatever it is that's going on with you, we're going through a process, right? So we generally understand that we feel secure that in the places that we are aching, we can call upon somebody that can help us through the situation that a doctor can't do, that a prescription can't do. That's something that is in our cabinet that's called Jack Daniels or vodka can't do. Or that marijuana joint that you roll up and smoke can't do. Where that stuff that's white pollen and put it up in your nose can't do. Where the sex that you're having out there illicitly with somebody that's not your wife or husband can't do. I'm here to let you know that we have an assignment that God has given us because we are fragile. We got to understand that when we come into the realm of God and we're looking at how we are our treasures. We got treasures in the jars of our bodies and the spirit of our bodies, who is Jesus Christ. We have an assignment. We have a responsibility to stay. Research on this message. I was like, can we check this out? How many of y'all know, and you medical people in the house, y'all know this. How many of y'all know that the elements in the skin that covers our bodies is only worth $4.50? Unless you got a whole grill of gold in your mouth. Y'all see some of these brothers and sisters out here? They got all that gold in their mouth. So that takes their little net worth up a little bit. But we also got some cowboys in the house. They got steer, got cows and stuff. Y'all know what cowhide is. How much is a 25 a square foot of cowhide worth? A square foot of cowhide. When I did the research on that thing, it said that it's only about 25 cents per square foot. And our skin is worth $3.50. Come on, man. So we just hear, it's not mathematically impossible to understand that we are really not all that. We are who we are, but we are who we are because of God. That brother by the name in the book of Genesis spoke about this thing. He said the earthen vessels or jar of clay are like the human body, and frail and fragile and easily returned to dust form or clay. It says, from dust we came and from dust we shall return. So what is going on here? If God is living in us, he's using us for a reason. Don't you know that 1 Corinthians chapter 1 says God deliberately chose things to make the world look foolish in order to shame those who think they are wise. And he chose the powerless to shame those who are powerful, who think they're powerful. God chose things despised by the world, misfits, things counted as nothing at all, misfits, and use them to bring to nothing what the world considers important, so that no one can ever boast in the presence of the Lord. We were all misfits at one time. If we weren't misfits, we would still be out there in the world. The world is totally not with us who are believers. And we have to understand that the contrast and the treasure that is within you and I is also letting us It says, it is not by force or by strength, by my spirit, says the mighty God. Then you will know that the Lord Almighty has sent me. So God is working in us. He's reminding us that I am the true vine. I am the one who remains strong for you all. I am the one that's allowing you to go through and do the things you're going to do. You are one of the branches. Those who remain in me and I in them will produce what? More fruit. Because a part of me, you can't do nothing. If I took my cup and took it and threw it against the wall right now, it crashed. It'd break in a million pieces. I can't put it back together. I'm not going to do it either because I get in trouble. But I'm just saying, we can't do anything apart from Jesus Christ. So the second point that I was looking at was that God lives and is seen through people who may get knocked around but never stop being available to be used by him. This is where when I started thinking about that scripture, I said, wow, people talk about how God wants to demonstrate his glory through the position that you may have in your church, the position you may have on your job, the square footage of your house. You know what I'm saying? What kind of car you driving? The model of your car, the measure of your health, the money that you even have in the bank. People will try to look at that and say, man, well, God is in all of that. God is the glorious one because he's done that for that person and all of that kind of stuff. Well, take all that stuff away and see what they do. Take everything away and see what they do. Do them like you did Job. Take all that away and see if they will go ahead and continue to serve you. Because the glory of God is the most evident thing that people have to go around and deal with, especially when you're one of those folks who get knocked around their lives. We have to continue to stay in the game regardless of what we have. Because the day we may have it, and tomorrow we not. This pandemic that's going on, we're going through this situation, the sickness that's happening, the reoccurrence of people getting contact with this virus is still there. The war is still going on. But we have got to continue to keep our faith. We have to continue to know that even in sickness, we are covered by the Lord. We have to know even until the death of when we die on this day or whatever day God has planned for us, we will be victorious in him. Because verse 8 through 10 is talking about this thing. It's saying that we may be pressed on every side because of the troubles that we're having in life. But we are not crushed, y'all. It says that we may have be at our wits' ends. We may be at the edge of that curve where we want to walk off in front of a bus or a train. But we have to know that without a shadow of a doubt, our hope never ends because we have a hope in Jesus Christ. We have to also know that we are persecuted on every hand. We're persecuted. My wife talked about that. Women. You women are persecuted on every hand when it comes down to medical situations. And they're persecuted on other things as well. Brothers, we're persecuted as well too. But don't you know God will never abandon us. God will never turn his back on us. God will never tell us that I'm not going to be there for you when you go to the doctor and you get that prognosis about some situation in your life. God's not going to tell you I'm not going to be there with you when you got to go before the court and have to pay a heavy fine for something that you did. God's not going to say I'm not going to be with you when it's time for you to pack your bags and leave your comfortable home because a situation came where you had to move because you were renting a house and now they want to sell the house. So now you got to get out and go find you another place to live. God's not going to abandon you when you're getting your guts kicked out by the way society is treating each and every one of us in this building today. We may be knocked down, but we will get up strong. we need to grow. I'm here to tell you that the Bible is right. The Bible tells me that as long as I continue to keep my focus on Him, as long as I continue to call upon the name of the Lord, that He will be with me. He will be with me through the hard knocks of my life. He will be with me during the time when I can't even look in the mirror and smile because I'm having a great day. He's always there with us to help us when we're getting back to ground. We are never alone. Others are going through the same stuff we are going through too. So don't think that we got carte blanche on having situations in our lives that aren't right. We also find strength in the knowledge that God doesn't abandon us when the ship is sinking. How do we know that? Well, Paul talked about that, right? Because he was on that one of those ships, and he said, man, this ship is getting ready to sink. But he said, the Lord stood by me. That just blew me away when I read that. I said, my God. So my last point is this. He said, God lives and is seen through people who look and live beyond their own usefulness. God is in the midst of everything that we do. We live under constant danger. Verses 11 through 12 says, because we serve a God who is greater than any of us. So that the life of Jesus will be obvious in our dying bodies. We're dying right now. We look like we're alive, right? We're all dying. Amen. That's the truth of the matter. So when we live in the face of death, it is the result in the eternal life that God has for us. Because at the end of the day, when the curtain goes down, we're going to go up and be with the Lord. Woo! We live our lives so that others may see the presence of God and receive Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. And I'm telling you, sometimes when we people look at us, sometimes we don't answer the bell like we should. amen. I'm a witness to that. Sometimes we skid a little bit and we slip on a banana peel or whatever it is you want to call it. We have issues. But when people that see that, first thing they want to do is criticize you. Well, you spoke for one of them Christians. You're not supposed to get mad. You're not supposed to have an attitude. You're supposed to run around here like you got every day. But don't you know the blood runs warm in my veins just like a person out here in the world? Circumstances come and will try to overtake us. But I always say, I got a rock that I can hold on to. I got a Savior that will forgive me and change my whole will bring somebody in my presence that will help me get it through. But there's a story that I want to just bring up. I like to find little stories, right? And I don't know why I couldn't find a story about the New England Patriots. I did find a good story. And it's a story about this washed out third string NFL quarterback who ends his career playing for a team over in Italy called the Parma Panthers. And there was a fullback on the team by the name of Franco. I'm just saying. And this guy, Franco, was an avid fan of Franco Harris, right? Y'all remember Franco Harris, those of you who like football, who played for the Pittsburgh Steelers during the time of Terry Bradshaw. But anyway, Franco Harris broke all of Jim Brown's records, and that upset me. Franco Harris was His father was African American, his mother was Italian. But this guy Franco loved Franco Harris because he was a great Italian football player at his time. And this guy over in Italy modeled his own semi-pro career after his idol Franco Harris. He wore his number. In his mind, he thought he was Franco Harris every time he ran that ball. He was a fire plug at running back. But many of you know that in this day and in this life, we all don't have a Franco Harris mentality. We don't have that type of mentality that's going to get us through the situations that we live in. And even though the Pittsburgh Steelers were pretty good back then, Robert, Mr. Dr. Mayfield, the people that live in our life and we that are living through us, that are looking at what we're doing and wanting to be like us as believers, should be the same mindset as this guy named Franco that played for this Italian football team about Franco Harris. He wanted to be so much like him. And we should always exhibit what people want to be like us and follow Jesus Christ. This guy was faithful all the way to the end of his days of playing football. And we have to be faithful in allowing God to continue to dwell in our jar of clay. The precious cargo that we're carrying in our hearts is Jesus Christ. Because we know at the end of the day, when he died for our sins, he died for a reason, right? He died because he gave us the opportunity to have everlasting life. And I tell you, with that, I can't even compare that to anything else in life. Everlasting life with Jesus is all that I'm looking for. Because I can't do nothing without him. I know too much about him to turn back now. That's why when I think about Miss Birdie, and I think about the things that she's been through, and the things that she has gone through, and how she left her legacy here. She left an awesome legacy, amen. And she left a legacy not only with her family, but everybody that came in touch. And this is what my prayer is, that we all can do the same.
Amen.
God bless you. Father God, we just thank you for this day. We thank you for this opportunity, Lord, just to talk about Jesus for a while. And we thank you for looking out for each and every one of us, Lord. We think about the good times, we think about the bad times, but we know even in the meantime, you are with us and not against us. And they're so happy and joyful knowing that you died on the cross and you were resurrected on the third day and you went to heaven. And now we have the opportunity to be right there with you when you decide to come back and get us. And we just pray that you will continue to use each and every one of us in a mighty way. Continue to take these jars of clay that we are and continue to mold us and shape us. And even if you have to break us, do what you have to do, Lord, so that your will be done in our lives. And we just love you in the matchless name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. If there's anybody in the house that's not saved, I gotta put that out there because this is soul saving time. These days are really starting to come to an end. And so people who are not saved need to get saved. If you don't have a Bible-based church, join a church, get saved, go to church. Learn the word of God. Learn what salvation is all about in your life. Do what you need to do. Get baptized. We had an awesome baptism yesterday. The Holy Ghost was up in here. So just let you know that God is still in a blessing business. And just allow him to do what he's going to do. So if there's anybody in Facebook land that needs to be saved,
just raise your hand. Anybody that needs to be in the house that needs to be saved, you can raise your hand or come to the altar. Anybody that's on a conference call line that needs to be saved, you might have drugged somebody with you to sit down and listen to the service today. Just know that all you have to say is, Lord, thank you, God, for being who you are in my life. I believe that you are the Son of God, and I am a sinner. And I thank you, God, if you would just take me in your heart and forgive me for all of my sins that you took to the cross, and I will be your servant. That's all you got to say. Praise be God. Amen. Amen. So all y'all just go ahead and have a great rest of the day. Thank God for you out there in Facebook land. I want to tell all the pastors and preachers for keep preaching the gospel, y'all. Keep doing Jesus Christ. And he will do what he needs to do for you. God bless you all. Have a blessed day. Well, yeah, that's right. Thank you, Reverend. It's good to have a backup over here. Any visitors in the house? Would you like to stand up and just say hello? All the visitors in the house, just jump up. Say, how you doing, real brother? What's going on, man? What's happening? I need to see you after the service. Yeah, I need time, peace. We can talk to you about that. But anybody else? Any other visitors in the house? Because everybody's family, right? Amen. Good to see you, Steph. Good to see you, baby. Amen. 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 All right. Well, all minds stay on the Lord. We do have to remind everyone too, to vote. VOTE. That means get out there and vote. You see what's happening on the news, but they're trying to put obstacles in the way. But I do believe that the Lord is going to prevail and allow this voting process to go forward, regardless of what they're trying to do and what they're trying to say. Amen. So, but don't forget to go vote. Amen. All right. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Anybody else got any announcements of anything that we need to put out there today?
Amen. Just going to say thank you.
Yes, I was going to talk. Yeah, my cousin, Minister Crawford, she had a heart attack a couple of days ago. It's been 2 days now. But you know how good God is? She sent me a message later on that night and said, hey, guess what? She said, I look better than what I've been through. Yeah. I said, my God, I got it. Put a stent in her heart and she's doing well. But she's still in the hospital.